Hi everyone and welcome back to my channel. Today I am channeling my inner Newton by sitting here under a passion fruit vine, and I'm going to be looking through something that actually really excites me, and that is Newton's great work. It is in Latin the Philosophiae Naturalis Principia Mathematica, or translated to English, The Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy. So this is a super important book to the history of science. It is where we were introduced to Newton's laws, talking about motion, things like the inverse square law, laws of gravity that keep large bodies in orbit, and some really nice insights just about the physical world. So this was first published in 1687, although this version here is not an original. It has since been translated into English by Andrew Mott and then revised by Florian Cajori. So that's a copy that I have here. And in this video, we're just going to be taking a look through this book and having a look at some of these key insights and at some of the science in the way that it was first presented to us. The writing of this book kind of came about after Newton was visited by his friend Edmund Halley after Halley's comet fame, and Halley wanted to know from Newton, what are your thoughts on, what motion heavenly bodies would follow if they're governed by this inverse square law that they were starting to think about? And Newton said, I've already worked it out, they're going in ellipses, and I'll send you my calculations. So in writing up, all of his thoughts and calculations around that, it eventually evolved into this book, which ended up laying kind of a foundation for classical mechanics that we still learn and use today. It apparently took Newton about 1.5 years of solid focused work to work on this manuscript and get it out there. He had to put some of his side interests like alchemy on hold for a little bit to get this out, and we're very glad that he did. It's very important and I'm really excited to have a look at it, so let's see what's inside. So here it is, the book which helped to bring the tools of mathematics to physics and helped to bring us a really great period of science. The book starts off with a page of definitions where Newton is defining things like mass, momentum, inertia, and centripetal force. These just set up the rest of the book, and then we go into the axioms or laws of motion. Now these are arguably the most famous aspects of this book, and these are Newton's laws 1, 2, and 3 listed here. And these are still laws that you would learn about in any physics class or lecture today, and they're still very useful and relevant. Now we'll come back to reading through some of these laws to see how Newton laid them out. We'll come back to that in a minute, but we'll just have a look at what's in the rest of this book. So after the axioms and explaining them a bit, we get on to book 1 of 3 in this work, which is the motion of bodies. Now that's pretty much what it sounds like. It's how things move and how you can describe the motion of pretty much everything. Although in this first book, we're only talking about the motion of bodies moving through free space. There's no resisting medium. And that leads us into what book 2 is about, which is the motion of bodies in resisting mediums. So I guess you have a little bit more to consider here, he really talks about every case that you can think of when you want to know about motion. There's also plenty of diagrams and mathematical explanations, which I guess are good because the language in this book, I must say, can be a little confusing at the best of times. It was originally written in Latin and it's been translated to English here, but even then, I find it very difficult sometimes to figure out what's going on and what they're actually referring to. So maybe the diagrams do actually help out quite a bit. Now, there is actually a third book, which I don't have included here in my copy, which is on the system of the world. And it's more about astronomy and applying these concepts of motion to astronomy. But since I don't have that one here, we'll just going to be talking about books 1 and 2. So I've taken us back to the definitions page just to have a little read of some of these to see what the language is like. So for the first definition here, it's actually talking about mass. And he says, the quantity of matter is the measure of the same, arising from its density and bulk conjointly. Now, this language about the measure of the same could actually be read as the quantity of matter is the measure of matter arising from its density and bulk conjointly, which to me makes a little bit more sense when you read it that way. So that's mass. And then we have another definition here. It reads in a very similar way. The quantity of motion is the measure of the same, arising from the velocity and quantity of matter conjointly. So that there is actually talking about momentum. So you'll still see the definition of momentum given in textbooks everywhere as usually P for momentum is equal to mv, which is matter and velocity. So nothing has really changed there in physics. We then go on to talk about what is actually inertia, or as it's called here, an innate force of matter. It is a power of resisting by which every body, as much as in it lies, continues in its present state, whether it be of rest or of moving uniformly forwards in a right line. So that's just talking about inertia. We haven't got on to any of Newton's laws yet. These are just setting up definitions for what we're going to go and talk about. So we've got some other things like an impressed force or a centripetal force. There's also quite a lengthy discussion at the end of these definitions where Newton splits up the definition of centripetal force into its absolute quantity, its accelerative quantity, and its motive quantity. And then has a bit of a long-winded discussion here about what is absolute true and mathematical time, or the same with, you know, absolute true and mathematical space or motion. And I think he's just trying to clear up confusion about, I guess, what exact properties he is referring to for the rest of the book. So yeah, this is a pretty long section here, which I'll admit is not the easiest to follow, but we get to this page, our laws of motion. Let's see if you can recognize these laws. For number one, we have that every body continues in its state of rest or of uniform motion in a right line, unless it is compelled to change that state by forces impressed upon it. So yeah, that actually makes sense, and there's just a little explanation here. And then we have law two. So the change of motion is proportional to the motive force impressed and is made in the direction of the right line in which that force is impressed. Now, I believe this second law could be written in a more familiar way as F is equal to ma. So a super important equation in physics. I guess this is it written out in its long-winded original form. But, you know, that's actually kind of a revolutionary law because it is so useful in so many areas of physics. And it's neat to see, you know, Newton talking about it in sort of his own words here. So law number three, it's also might be a little familiar for you. It is that to every action, there is always opposed an equal reaction, or the mutual actions of two bodies upon each other are always equal and directed to contrary parts. And again, I think that one's not too hard to understand, especially if you've seen it recently in your own classroom. So yeah, then we just have a few corollaries. Newton, you know, giving some little bits of evidence or justification for his reasoning here, but we won't go through all of those now. We'll just go to the start of book one. So book one starts with a mathematical look at something called the method of first and last ratios, which to my understanding is like a geometrical form of infinitesimal calculus. So even though I believe Newton had already come up with his sort of, you know, version of calculus as we know it today by the time he wrote this book, he doesn't feature calculus in here and instead publishes calculus at a much later time. Now, whether he did that to make, you know, these proofs and things more understandable to other scientists and physicists at the time, I'm not sure. Or maybe he just wasn't ready to share some of his other, you know, theories and workings as of yet. But anyway, he proves a lot of these things very geometrically. And it's pretty impressive and interesting to just have a look at how some of these things are done. So this is, you know, a mathematical discussion here. And then we get into section two of book one, which says here, the determination of centripetal forces. So a lot of these first few propositions is talking about the relationship between centripetal forces and things like areas or, you know, circular motion and the radius of a path that would be travelled. So these actually relate to what we now know as Kepler's laws, and Kepler did actually come before Newton. So I think that Newton is building on some of those laws from Kepler here in this section. As we move through to propositions 5 to 10, we start to hear about the inverse square law, which, you know, says that centripetal force varies as the inverse square of the distance to the center. Now, I think it comes up here in proposition 6. We see it just mentioned at the end here that the centripetal force in the middle of an arc will be directly as the versed sign and inversely as the square of the time. And we've got a little semicircle diagram down here. Now it's a little bit hard to understand there, but you probably have encountered an inverse square law in a more familiar way as written like 1 over r squared. And lots of things like, you know, in this case, we could be talking about, you know, a gravitational attraction varying in strength as an inverse square law. So the further away from it you get, it drops off quite steeply because it's the inverse of the square. So that's kind of what we're talking about in this section here. And basically, we just get a lot of stuff about elliptical orbits, the motion of, you know, planets or other bodies. We get lots of things about centripetal force, and I think we'll just have a little skip through the rest of these. So coming to book two, the first section of it talks about the motion of bodies that are resisted in the ratio of the velocity. So, you know, resistance that is in direct proportion to velocity, which is not an alien concept to any physicist nowadays. So we talk about that a bit through some more propositions and some more geometrical arguments. Section 2 here then goes on to talk about the motion of bodies that are resisted as the square of their velocities. We have a few more sections here before we get on to section 5, which is hydrostatics, essentially the density and compression of fluids. So that's pretty cool. We're even talking about fluid dynamics here. And then for the next section, which is section 6, we get the motion and resistance of pendulous bodies. So that is the effects of air resistance on pendulums, and I think that Newton did a lot of experiments, so did other physicists at the time, with pendulums, so it makes sense that they get their own little sections. So yeah, that's pretty interesting that he was able to look at resistance and pendulums, and you can see that through his diagrams here. Like, this is all really impressive stuff, and I'm quite excited to see it laid out because I've never really seen it laid out in the way it was initially presented before. Now, one important aspect of this book, and it's stressed by Newton like at the start and through a lot of the language, is that
He's, for example, with all of his work about gravitation, he's not trying to provide any explanations or reasoning as to, you know, how gravity works and why, you know, bodies attract each other gravitationally. He doesn't, you know, give an explanation, and he doesn't try to give an explanation of that. So there is sort of a famous quote from Newton, and it came at the end of book three in this work, where he essentially says, "I feign no hypotheses." So there he says he's not claiming to really have any understanding of how gravity works, and I guess you could argue we still don't really know how gravity works, but here in this book, Newton is doing his best to show you the effects of it and how it will affect motion and how things will move under it. So I think I'm going to leave my little review of the book here, but because I was so excited to get a copy of this book and to read through it, I'm going to upload another video, hopefully tomorrow, where I'm just going to read the book and nothing else. So I'll see how far I can get through it without getting too tired, but maybe you can watch that if you want to, maybe, you know, put into your subconscious some of Newton's words and some of his phrasing. Or you just want to, you know, hear more about this language. So thanks for watching this video. I hope you found it a little bit interesting, and I'll see you next time.